Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The scriptures I'm reading are Proverbs 2, verses 2 through 11. You'll find it in your hymnal, but in the Bible, on page 986. Turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, and if you call out for insight, and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver, and search for it as for a hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He holds victory in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair, every good path. For wisdom will enter your heart and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will protect you and understanding will guard you. May God add his blessing to this reading of his word.
Wisdom, that is something that everybody would like to have. Everybody would like to be perceived as being wise, don't you? Whether you're Christian or atheist or Buddhist or whatever, you're being thought of as being a wise person. The dictionary says that wisdom is the ability to judge soundly and to deal with facts as they relate to life and conduct. Put more simply, a wise person is one who is able to apply knowledge to life. It's the combination of knowledge and common sense. Now, we usually think of older people as being wise, and older people should be wiser because they've had more time to accumulate that knowledge. They've lived more of life to develop more common sense and to deepen their understanding. But you don't have to be old to be wise. People of any age or background can have that perception and that broader perspective to be able to apply facts to everyday life. And so we admire people who are like that, and we desire that quality in ourselves. But do you also know what the Bible has to say about this wisdom? If we look at Ecclesiastes chapter 2, starting at verse 11, it says, "Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. Then I turned my thoughts to consider wisdom, and also madness and folly. What more can the king's successor do than what has already been done? I saw that wisdom is better than folly, just as light is better than darkness. The wise man has eyes in his head, while the fool walks in the darkness. But I came to realize that the same fate overtakes them both. Then I thought in my heart, the fate of the fool will overtake me also. What then do I gain by being wise? I said in my heart, this too is meaningless. For the wise man, like the fool, will not be long remembered. In days to come, both will be forgotten. Like the fool, the wise man too must die. So yes, wisdom is good. But in the end, so what? I'm wise. Big deal. Didn't get me anywhere. I'm going to die just like the fool. And so as great a thing as wisdom is, it isn't everything. Much of the New Testament was written in direct opposition to the concept called Gnosticism, which was a system of thought that was developed by the Greeks based on knowledge and philosophy, which is exactly what we said is the definition of wisdom, knowledge and the ability to apply it. Gnostics believed that their faith was to be based on what they could know and experience and then thus apply to life. The Bible says, no, faith is more than that. Faith is an actual relationship with God. So what about wisdom then? Is it of no use? Well, there are dozens of scriptures which speak of the value and importance of wisdom. So the conclusion that we have to make is that there is a difference between earthly wisdom and a wisdom that comes from God, a godly wisdom. It is godly wisdom that can make a tremendous difference in the life of a Christian. So as I investigated what the Bible says about godly wisdom, I made a list of things which marked or identified godly wisdom. and separated it from earthly wisdom. And as I was making that list, I came across Proverbs 2 that Pete read for us and found that this passage contained all the items on my list. So I said, there's my text for the morning. And even if I use no other scripture, everything I want to say is found right here in Proverbs 2. But I am going to use a lot of other scriptures. So I recommend that you go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Proverbs 2 or keep your finger there. And just hang on for the ride for the rest of it. We're going to put the rest of the verses on the screen. And we're going to keep Corbin on his toes this morning. So let's see how well he can keep up with me. Understand if he can't. We've got a lot of verses I want to share this morning. But the first mark of true godly wisdom is the fear of the Lord. As we see in our text for today, verse 5 of chapter 2 in Proverbs. Then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. This whole idea of the fear of the Lord is a prevailing theme found throughout the whole book of Proverbs, starting right in chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 7. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. Moving down to chapter 9, verse 10. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. And one more, chapter 15, verse 33. It says, the fear of the Lord teaches a man wisdom, and humility comes before honor. If a man does not have fear of the Lord, he is not wise. No matter how many degrees he has, no matter how smart he is, no matter how much knowledge he has, or how kind and generous he is, if he does not recognize the authority and the power of God Almighty, if he is not aware of the potential of God's wrath and judgment, if he has no regard for the wages of his own sin, or the enormous scope of what was required for his own redemption, then he's a fool. Romans 1:22 talks about such a person saying, claiming to be wise, they became fools, and exchange the glory of the immortal God for images. So wisdom, this earthly wisdom that we could have, is knowledge and applying it to life. Without the fear of the Lord, that just doesn't last. It's corruptible. It's just vanity. For rather than worshiping the Creator, who lasts forever, earthly wisdom worships the creature, who decays and dies. Now yes, people, God is our friend. He is our companion. He's our comforter, he's our confidant, he's all those things. But never become so chummy and familiar with him that you lose your fear of him, your respect and utter reverence. That would be a foolish thing to do. When there is fear of the Lord, then and only then can wisdom mean anything or get you anywhere. So that's the starting point. It's the beginning of knowledge. It's the beginning of wisdom. A second mark of wisdom has to do with its origin. Verse 6 in our passage says, for the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. So this godly wisdom is separated from earthly wisdom. That's something that's a gift. It's something that must be given to you. It's available to all, but it must be given and received. You remember the story of Solomon in 2 Chronicles when God offered to give him whatever he wanted. Solomon could have asked for anything, but he chose to ask for wisdom, and it was granted to him. We too can ask for wisdom and be granted it. Not the wisdom of the world, but the wisdom of God. James chapter 1:5 tells us that. Classic verse that says, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. So this godly wisdom that we're talking about is not something that can be just achieved or obtained by merely studying hard or just experiencing life, although those things are valuable tools of wisdom. But wisdom is a gift from God to believers who desire to have it. I think it's very important for us to make that distinction, that wisdom is a gift. But at the same time that it's a gift, it's also very costly. There's a price to pay for this gift. I know that sounds like a contradiction, but it's really not. Wisdom is a gift in that it is available to all who ask for it. Whether it's the foolish or the intellectual, whether it's the naive or the shrewd, or whether the rich or the poor, it comes by revelation of God for those who want it. But it also comes by discipleship. Those who want God's gift of wisdom must search for those hidden treasures of God, as verse 4 of Proverbs says, those treasures are found in a life of devotion to God, requiring those things that the rest of the passage says in verses 7 through 9, uprightness and integrity and justice and faithfulness. So that even though wisdom is a gift, the mark of wisdom is the life that you're leading. It's the kind of a disciple that you are. If you've received the gift, then others will be able to tell. And hopefully, they can see that the origin of your wisdom is God. If you put on a new shirt that you got, and someone says, oh, is that a gift? Did you get that? The new present? You say, yeah, it was a gift. It was given to me. Well, people should be able to see your wisdom and ask, well, where did that come from? Where did you get that? And you can say, it came from God. It's not me. It's God. A third mark of godly wisdom is that of being teachable, of yearning to learn and to know more, and not rejecting discipline. This is sort of like a coach who calls a player coachable. And he may have a player who is loaded with talent, much more than other players, but who is not coachable. He refuses to work on fundamentals or the whole concept of teamwork. And he won't be corrected. He thinks he already knows all that there is to know. He won't practice. That's something you know what I'm talking about there. Any good coach will tell you that he'd rather have one coachable player than three with talent who are not coachable. Hopefully he'll have players who are both talented and coachable. Well, spiritually speaking here, you can have earthly wisdom. It's not a bad thing. And you can still have godly wisdom, but only if you're teachable. Verses 3 and 4 of Proverbs 2 set up the points that we've already mentioned in verses 5 and 6. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and wisdom is, first of all, a gift from God. But you need to call out for insight, cry aloud for understanding, to look and search for it. You must be teachable. You must be willing to be disciplined by the Lord. This is another strong emphasis that is found throughout the whole book of Proverbs. Most of the chapters actually start out with this theme, starting in chapter 3, verse 1, which is, my son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart. Verses 11 and 12 of that same chapter say, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline, and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, as a father the son he delights in. And see, we see this repeated over and over. Listen to teaching. Accept discipline. Chapter 12, the very first verse, also does this. It says, whoever loves discipline loves knowledge, but he who hates correction is stupid. Very plainly put. Sometimes I don't like correction, and that means I'm stupid if I don't. Chapter 13, verse 1, says, a wise son heeds his father's instruction, but a mocker does not listen to him. Chapter 15, verse 32, it says, he who ignores discipline despises himself, but whoever heeds correction gains understanding. So godly wisdom is not just an attribute that you can have, it's actually an attitude of your life. You might think of someone in your life who is very smart, even wise. He or she is very philosophical and gives sound advice, and they're usually right, but they're so arrogant about it that you hate to admit it. And when they're wrong, you kind of inwardly smile and say, I guess you don't know everything, do you? I like to watch Jeopardy, and some of those people are so obnoxious, they know all these answers, but then when they miss one, I just kind of say, ah, that attitude isn't right either. But you just wish people weren't so arrogant about their wisdom. Godly wisdom is not arrogant. It's gentle. It's loving. Let's look at James again, chapter 3, starting with verse 13. It says, who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such, quote, wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, of the devil. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder in every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Another interesting point here in James is that wisdom is something which must be seen and not just said. You know, we usually think of wise people by what they say. Oh, he always has something wise to say. But godly wisdom is not just the ability to quote proverbs or to give advice, but to live out those proverbs in your own life. Wisdom must be observable to be credible. In chapter 2 of James, he says the same thing about faith. Faith that is only talked about and professed is not really faith at all. Faith must be seen by the deeds that you do. And so, likewise, a wise person is one who is teachable and who yearns for more knowledge and more experience and who is not arrogant. And, maybe most importantly, someone who relies on the Word of God for his wisdom. Jeremiah 8:9 says, "The wise will be put to shame. They will be dismayed and trapped since they have rejected the Word of the Lord." What kind of wisdom do they have? Godly wisdom has its source in the Word of God. Then the fourth mark of godly wisdom that we see here in Proverbs 2 is a balance between knowledge and discretion. Those two concepts are linked together, as we see in verses 10 and 11 of our text. It says, "For wisdom will enter your heart, and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will protect you, and understanding will guard you." These same two words, knowledge and discretion, or at least synonyms of those two words, are often combined throughout the whole book of Proverbs again. Let me show you a few examples of that. Chapter 1, verse 4 says, "For giving prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the young." Chapter 3, verse 20 says, "By his knowledge the deeps were divided, and the clouds let drop the dew. My son, preserve sound judgment and discernment. Do not let them out of your sight." Chapter 5, verse 2 says, "That you may maintain discretion and your lips may preserve knowledge." And then one more, chapter 8, verse 12 says, "I, wisdom, dwell together with prudence. I possess knowledge and discretion." So this godly wisdom we're talking about today is more than just having knowledge and being able to apply it to life. But wisdom requires discretion, sensitivity, tact, spiritual understanding. It's the balance that separates earthly wisdom from godly wisdom. Now, I know some very smart people who don't have an ounce of tact or sensitivity, let alone any spiritual understanding. I also know people who never really did all that well in school, maybe even mentally deficient, but who know God and who have experienced His grace and are therefore very wise. While a person with 150 IQ and all sorts of abilities and resources and experiences can still reject the greatest thing in the world, spiritual understanding is a gift from God, which is available to all. Without it, all the knowledge that you could possibly possess means nothing. Without it, there's no wisdom. There's no basis for living your life. And this is really the foundation of what Paul was saying to the Corinthians in chapter 1 of 1 Corinthians, which says in verse 21, "For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know Him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe." Skipping down to verse 25, which says, "For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength." And finally, verse 30, it says, "It is because of Him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption." It is Jesus Christ who has opened the door for us to receive wisdom. Without the context of eternal life that is found only through faith in Jesus, wisdom is of no value. We'll just die like everybody else. So what good is it? But when we know Jesus, then Jesus becomes for us wisdom from God. Jesus is the answer and is the only way to wisdom. Michael Carter, writing about the book of Proverbs, points to Jesus when he wrote the song, "The Way of Wisdom," which says, "The way of wisdom starts out with a step of holy fear, and it makes its way along by every good word that you hear. It has to do with passion, and it has to do with pain. It has to do with one who has both died and rise again. The way of understanding lies in not how much you know, for the pathway is a person that you come to love, and so you can stop pretending that it all depends on you. For For it's not how much you love as much as how much He loves you. And the way of wisdom is living. The path of peace is forgiving. Behold the man of meaning. Behold, he is the Lord. My friends, like Solomon, above all else, seek godly wisdom. Ask for the gift from God, and He will give it to you. Never lose the fear of the Lord. That's the most unwise thing you could ever do. Always be teachable, yearning to learn more, crying out for understanding, not being arrogant, but relying on the Word of God. Always seek to strike that balance between knowledge and discretion. Knowledge is very important. Always seek more. Also, always seek the spiritual understanding that separates godly wisdom from earthly wisdom. Godly wisdom is the wisdom that is made available through the blood of Jesus Christ. Maybe some of you are wise in the eyes of the world, and that's a good quality. I commend you for that. I invite you to the world of godly wisdom, and it's yours for the asking when you receive Christ as your own Savior, and you enter a whole new realm of living. I'd like to invite you to make a decision today to accept Christ if you have not done so, and to receive from Him the gift of godly wisdom.